Welcome to this video and podcast edition. If you are listening to the audio mode only, I am Emil Badarin, and today I would like to talk about the perceptions of China in the global south. For millennia, the East, or countries in the East, such as China, India, the Islamic Caliphate, the Mongols, Safavids, and other nations, and many other kingdoms and nations in Africa, were the center of civilization, of innovation, of thought and knowledge. In short, they were and have a long history of being the center of gravity. And yes, they occupied adjacent territories, but they didn't seek to dominate these nations or transform their ways of being, much less dominate the world. And we often understand the world and other nations, both in the past and the present, from the European modern concepts and structures and system of thought, as if it is the standard and the way to measure everything against. In reality, this European modernity or the Enlightenment and the kind of system of thought that it is built on are relatively new. They are only 500 years old. And since its creation, it has been predicated on the idea of sovereignty, on a sovereign Europe, a sovereign Christian white male dominating non-Europeans as well as nature. This system of thought is based on a racialized distinction of the world's population and a violent and extractivist relationship to other species, the planet, as well as non-Europeans. Why didn't these mighty powers that existed before the rise of modern Europe behave in the same way as Europe has been doing for the last 500 years? The kind of answer and explanation we are given often uses instrumental reason and rationalism, and this is the basis of European modernity and the Enlightenment itself. They refer often to the kind of technologies that were brought about by European modernity, the Industrial Revolution, the bigger ships, the weaponry that were produced as a result of that knowledge or that mode of knowledge production. But didn't other nations, such as China, have also formidable power? They had also technology, civilization, and knowledge before Europe. They were the ones who invented the gunpowder. They had even guns 500 years. They have access to guns 500 years before the Europeans knew anything about guns and gunpowder. So why they didn't colonize the nations and the areas and the territories they reached? And in fact, they reached many parts of the world. They had a formidable navy, much bigger and mightier than any other nation at that time in the 14th or 15th century. Yet they did not try to colonize these nations. They reached Africa and traded with its different kingdoms and different people and different nations. And they didn't try to dominate Africa. They didn't try to exploit Africa and steal its wealth as the Europeans have been doing. What makes the difference is not technology or the tools. What makes all the difference is the kind of thought structure that underlie these different civilizations. This leads to the first point that I would like to stress here, is the fact that people in the global south have their own thought structures. It is a big mistake to try to explain China or any other civilization for that matter by using Western tools of thought. And people in the West, actually, they are used to impose their own thoughts and their own ideas on others as if they are the standard of civilization and the standard to measure the rest of the world against. But what you will get if you do that is only an inverted image of the West itself. People in the global South understand that China has its own thoughts, its own civilization, its own interests and ambition in the world. They also have a long history with China, a non-colonial relationship to China, a cultural relationship, religious, economic, trade, and so on, that goes back in time millennia. Whereas the relationship to the modern West or to Europe, modern Europe, is a colonial one, is a one that is based on violence, domination, and extraction. That relationship does not exist with China. They know that China has also wants to develop its global profile and develop its interest in the world. They know that it is not a charity, and they don't need the West to come and lecture them about China and how to deal with China. They don't need them to spread their discourse of fear, as we will see in this conversation in a moment between the Namibian president and African leader with another European, white European diplomat. I think he's a German. He was the president of the German Bundestag. Let's watch this conversation and then get back to our discussion.
Whereas in Namibia, for example, the number of Chinese people living here in the meantime is four times as much as, for example, the German community. And in so far, it's not precisely the same what takes place all over the world. There are differences. And what I'm...
Mr. Speaker, what is your problem with that? Why does it become your problem? it looks like it's a more European problem than our problem. Yeah. You are so sorry for us. I don't see... Chinese will never come and play around here. As Germans not allowed to do that. Which Germans are doing, by the way. You talk about Chinese. We allow Germans to come offer visas here. Red carpet. Our people are harassed in Germany. Even diplomatic passport holders. In Germany. And you come in here, Germans come in here as they want. So why Chinese talk about Germans? How you are treating us there? Chinese don't treat us like that. Diplomatic passport holders. We're coming back from Geneva. These people were held up at the airport. Just now, last week, in Germany. We know how to, we will handle our own country. Don't be sorry for us.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. Every time Westerner comes, it's about Chinese. What is the problem? Is Namibia a problem of Chinese? Did you tell Western Namibians that Chinese have overtaken Namibia? Not in my on my watch. I told Chinese ambassador, yeah, I'm not your puppet. It was in press everywhere. And so please, respect us. That's all I would say. It shows disrespect that we are children, we are going to be cajoled by Chinese or so on. No. Chinese are coming in infrastructure all over Africa. And I saw in America, they are there. Who bailed Americans out from the financial crisis? Chinese money is there.
As we gather from this exchange between an African leader and an ex-colonizer, between this European politician, and if you know the history of Namibia and Germany, the colonial history and the genocidal history of these two countries, where actually Germany genocided almost 50% of the Namibian population in the beginning of the 20th century. So that exchange reveals the kind of relationship, the kind of colonial and patronizing relationship between the West and the global South. To understand that more, let's dissect this a little bit more and consider how power has been structured in the last five centuries to grasp what I mean here. One of the important theories to understand the structures of power that was created by European modernity is this theory about the colonial matrix of power, which was introduced by Impal Quijano, a Peruvian sociologist. And that explains to us the nature of power and the nature of structures that govern the present day coloniality. Almost everywhere you go, the type of authority we have is built on the European system. It's a nation state wherever you go. So the power we have and the kind of sovereignty is based on a colonial origins. The kind of economy, it is extractivist and violent economy, which is capitalism almost everywhere. the gendered and racialized distinction of people and separation of people and ranking based on their color, their belonging, and their religion. And that's another structure. And the fourth structure is the system of knowledge production. The dominant ways of producing knowledge is still based on European ways of thinking. And that's why we try to grasp and think of China and explain China from European tools as if these tools are standard. Because that system of thought and knowledge production has been made to be dominant since the last few centuries. But people in the global south, for quite a long time, they were plugged into this matrix of power, so they had no options. And this became even more so in the 1990s, after the collapse of the Soviet Union and the emergence of the so-called unipolar system. So countries in the global south, for quite a long time, they had no choice. Yeah. So if a country in the global south want to develop anything, they have to go and choose between different countries in the West, Germany, if not Germany, then France, the UK, America, and so on and so forth. And to understand that even more, to give you an empirical insight into this, let's watch this clip.
This is the copper belt in Zambia. Beneath the ground are the largest copper reserves in Africa, an essential commodity in the global economy.
Glencoe, under Glencoe, yes.
Today, virtually all Zambian copper mines are owned by multinational corporations. In 10 years, they've extracted copper worth more than $29 billion.
As a country, as a nation, God has blessed us with such an abundant natural resource. Now, the paradox is that Zambia is ranked among the bottom 20 in terms of poverty, 20 poorest countries. We are wealthy, yet we are poor.
A lot of people think that we in the West have been extremely generous in the amount of foreign aid that we provide to the developing countries and particularly to Africa. Globally, our estimate is that the amount of money flowing out of developing countries is 10 times the amount of foreign aid flowing into developing countries.
Only a 30-minute drive from Rüschlikon is the headquarters of Glencore, owner of one of the biggest mining operations in Zambia. Glencore is the world's largest integrated commodities trader, with a yearly turnover on more than $180 billion, more than eight times the gross national product of Zambia. Glencore controls Mopani copper mines in Zambia through a 73% stake. All copper produced by Mopani is sold internally to Glencore in Switzerland.
Your company is a major investor in the developing world. We believe developing countries need more investment, not less.
Part of Glencore's Zambian operations have been suspended by the environmental authorities.
I wish you a pleasant flight.
Captain Nyika, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Vice President Guy Scott is visiting the plant and has invited me along. Residents have complained that mist containing diluted acid is drifting from the plant to their homes. This is not the first time the plant has come to the attention of the Zambian authorities. In 2005, acid spills from the plant contaminated drinking water in a nearby township. Ivan Glasenberg made $8.8 billion on the IPO. 400 other Glencore employees made more than $100 million each. In late 2012, former British Prime Minister Tony Blair was brought in to help negotiate an $80 billion merger between Glencore and the mining giant Xstrata. If successful, the merger will almost double the company's size and influence in the world.
As you can see here, the West has been dominating the global South and still is for quite a long time, and has been also depleting it of its own wealth and resources. Things began to change since the 2000s with the emergence of the multipolar system, or the polycentric system, if you wish to say, which is basically the same structure that existed before the rise of the European modernity. So people began to have more options and more things to choose from, especially with the rise of China. And this is precisely why China is so important to the global South, because it's central to the major global South geopolitical formations to push the West and its domination back. Now China is central to the many of the geopolitical formations of the global South, which they created to push back against the European domination and coloniality and the robbery that has been going on for centuries. China provides political and financial supports to these platforms such as the G77, the Non-Aligned Movement, the BRICS, the BRICS Development Bank, the SIBS financial system as alternative to the European SWIFT one, and the infrastructure and technology development in these countries. So in other words, China gives the Global South another options to choose from and to go away and break that colonial relationship that was established between themselves and Europe for quite a long time. The second point I would like to make is the fact that China itself is part of the Global South. Let's remember that it was only in 1997 that colonial Britain left Hong Kong. And even Portugal left Macau only in 1999, in December 1999, after colonizing it since 1557. For countries in the Global South, China provides a model, not necessarily not to emulate, but a model to learn from. For centuries, the dominant narrative that the Global South received from Europe is that they cannot develop, they cannot economically develop and jump on the train of progress unless they emulate Europe. They must reform and give up their culture and their history and just become and do stuff the same way Europe has been doing. In short, they need to become Europeans, which is impossible because Europe is predicated and built on racial distinctions. So that recipe in itself is a perpetual framework for continuing poverty. So the rise of China and other nations repudiates that narrative. China, India, and other countries, Brazil, and so on and so forth, they show the Global South that they can do it by excavating and reviving the treasures of their own culture and civilization and history. They can learn from their own material, so to speak. It shows that the Global South countries, that also they can do it without Western domination, without the Western humiliation, and they can recover themselves and their identity. And this makes a major, major difference. Countries in the Global South, they realize that they can get their technologies, infrastructure, power, economy, hospitals, and so on working without being culturally dominated, without losing their own identity and who they are. And this leads me to my third and last point. China provides the Global South what they ask for, and by invitation, not conquest. Culture is the mother of all domination, and in fact, China does not seek to impose its culture on the Global South or anyone else. And this connects to my first point about the different thought structures that underlie these different civilizations and powers. In the West, the idea of salvation, which is based on Latin Christianity, and the idea of progress, of saving the world, rests on a linear and future-oriented thinking. China doesn't have that idea. They have instead a cyclical understanding of history. What goes round comes round. China's intervention in the global south are not normative or cultural. Take, for example, the Road and Belt Initiative. You will find no cultural component there, no attempt to impose China's culture on these countries. Instead, it focuses on infrastructure projects, investment, banking, telecommunication, information technology, and so on. There's no cultural transformation. And cultural transformation is another face to the elimination, to the colonial elimination. You have with settler colonialism the elimination of the indigenous people, their physical presence on the land. But with the cultural elimination, the focus here on eliminating people's identity, history, or their metaphysics. And that kind of colonialism, the cultural one, is much profounder and deeper form of domination because it involves colonizing the souls of the subjugated people, as Fanon would argue. So that coloniality reproduces itself into the future without necessarily having or needing Europe to go there and be on the ground. China does not do that. It doesn't aspire to spread or enforce its culture and ways of being and doing things on others. So with China, the rules of the game follow the same logic of the millennia-long relationship between China and the rest of Asia, Africa, and other nations in the global south. It is cyclical, continuous, and a long-term relationship. It's not transactional. And most important of all, it is by invitation, not conquest, as has been happening between Europe and the global south for the last 500 years. It is a relationship that is based on conquest, violence, and extraction. Thank you for watching and listening to this talk, and I hope you found it useful and informative, and I look forward to having another one.